the game goes longer, they have map control, like that's very important, like in late game. So I think that they definitely want to pressure him as much as they can in the laning phase.
There's only a couple heroes with blanket like silence that can actually keep a Tidehunter from casting Ravage ever. Disruptor and Doom are the two, but both of them haven't banned out.
Don't you think Disruptor would also be nice on Liquid side for against the Slark?
Yeah.
They could also pick it up for themselves.
What did you say?
For Disruptor. I mean, they banned Disruptor because Ben mentioned it's really good at locking down the Tide, preventing the Ravage, but I'm saying that it's also really good against the Slark. Oh, that's a hero that we haven't seen in a while.
Okay, Bane.
Good hero.
Good lane presence, especially setting up kills with Nightmare into Sunstrike.
As we're waiting for Liquid's last pick then, with the Bane now coming out, how do you feel about Wings' roster overall?
Well, they need to do very well in the laning phase, so they can actually transition into what they are very good at in the mid to late game with their vision, speed push, catch. So lane is very important once again for Wings.
They have great great lockdown potential, and it's gonna be Lone Druid might actually struggle a bit. It's gonna be the Phantom Lancer that they rely more on, I think.
And they're going greedy again.
Yeah, coming back out. How do you feel? This time, obviously, Bounty are not on the game. Does that change it, though? I mean, you don't look so convinced, Winner.
No, I think it's, again, very greedy, and they, once again, can lose all their lanes. Their lanes come under a lot of pressure, and it's going to be difficult for them.
Okay, Merlin, some last thoughts on that roster from Team Liquid?
They have teamfight superiority, but again, I'm not sure if they're going to get through an early game to make it to that point where 5-on-5s will be king.
I would have much rather seen a Lion pick up. I don't know what suddenly happened for Lions to completely fall out of favor in this tournament. Went from being one of the most contested picks, and then after Secret stopped picking it yesterday, we just haven't really seen it since.
Yeah, definitely gone quiet, but the draft has changed quite entirely, it seems, so far in Day 3, especially in this Grand Final. Well, right now, Wings is leading 1-0. Liquid still going for a style that they're used to. Can they pick it back up here in Game 2 to tie up the series in a best of 5, or will Wings have finally figured it out to take the trophy home? Let's go into Game 2, find out if it'll be a 2-0 score afterwards or 1-1 with our commentators.
Thank you very much. Yes, it is time to get our Grand Final underway again. Game number 2 coming up. Team Liquid, they lost their first game ever here at ESL 1 Manila. And now, fresh slate, but the panel is a little bit concerned about the laning phase.
Yeah, the panel is definitely concerned, but at the same time, I think Liquid are really happy because they got a Jerix Earth Spirit. If Wings win this game too, they're going to be so confident, right? Because this has been one of the big beasts of Liquid that no one wants to give up.
Yeah, this is something that will open up the draft for them more than anything. If they feel confident that they can give up this hero.
Ice Ice. Does he go for the Fissure? He will. It's Pumman does have Doppelganger available, getting it leashed up. And Doppelganger himself, Wake, got the max range 1-2 again.
Not quite the hero that they wanted to run into with that smoke. They just don't have enough stuns to be able to catch a Phantom Lancer.
Almost any other hero that would have been the first blood is they are going to get control of the jungle right here. I think this is probably even the bigger play.
Yeah, that's the primary focus, right? If you run into and get a kill or some sort of surprise team fight, that's okay, but it's about taking control.
Yeah, you want to make sure that the Enigma especially gets a slower jungling phase, especially since this kind of lineup is a lot harder for Wings to invade. And I think that's part of the reason why they took this Bane. They wanted something that could get mobile, that could trade hits with the offlaner, and at the same time allow this Earthshaker to get a lot of space to do what he wants.
Yeah, last time we had the Bounty Hunter who was able to be a disruptive force against Crow, as well as being able to soak up like half of his experience. And we also had a lot of invasion coming out from Wings, but this time it's just not there. So need to do everything they can. Even the little things can help stop an Enigma from being able to get that mech in time. Let's talk about our hero matchups though, Blitz. We've got the Phantom Lancer versus Invoker, which you've seen this matchup before. It's been kind of a rising pick. This is one of the heroes dedicated to being able to beat a PL in lane, actually started out in the Southeast Asian scene.
Yeah, you're just able to rush on top of him. Invoker can't really trade hits early. The Spirit Lance is quite good at harassing him. And more than anything, your base damage is quite high on the Phantom Lancer, so pretty hard to trade hits. More importantly though, it's really easy to set up kills with the Spirit Lance. You can chase people down with the Phantom Rush. And that's why you see the Earthshaker in this game. He's essentially just there to neutralize Jerix.
And at the bottom lane, we have Mind Control, who's going to be playing the Tidehunter, but he's matched up against a lane that is super tough. It's going to be a Bane and Slurk. Sleep into a Pounce. What can you do as a Tidehunter?
How do you even contest up against that? And where's your help come from? Right now, Kuro can't even come down to help him. They've blocked up three of his camps, even though one of them is still already spawned up. So Kuro's got no space to go in the jungle. And Jirax, he was looking for a gank on mid. Instead now, he moves up towards the top lane. Kuro's coming in with an extra stun, and they got an opportunity right now here on face. Wait for the extra stun timer as he starts to run himself away. There's your first Malifus. Jirax, he needs to get in front of him and get the body block off. Can't do it, so just physically attack him down in face. Will be the first blood going in favor of Team Liquid. Jirax, however, is stuck in the tree. The Sunstrike is still first on level, and he'll boulder himself to safety.
Good read by Jirax, because if he actually runs back through that tower, most likely the invoker is going to be throwing the Sunstrike, leads it, and will be able to hit him with the extra tower damage. He probably dies and gets a return kill, and that's not what he's hoping for. So just calmly sits there, waits for the next rolling boulder, and that's Liquid making the best out of this situation where the Enigma is having his camps blocked out, him being able to rotate and gank up that Beastmaster. Part of the problem is going to be is that between the Enigma and the Earth Spirit, they're looking to try and jungle and also gank mid lane. The Beastmaster gets a lot of space, but Liquid putting pressure.
Oh, it's happening again. You can initiate down on bottom lane over on Mind Control, but he's just so tanky. And Mind Control, okay, with the Fissure Block, consumes at the Fairy Fire. He's dropping down very, very low. At the same time, up on top lane, you're actually going to lose faith to the three-man gank. So both safe lanes are able to find the pickoffs on the off laners.
I think both these off lanes are super scary, the Tidehunters especially, given that he can't actually use that cleanse of the Kraken Shell to be able to get rid of these disables, like the Pounce that's keeping him in place. Both are drawing a lot of attention though, and most specifically, Mind Control's lane is pushing forward, which is really beneficial to him. Yes, he's going to die in this lane quite a bit, but as long as he still gets the levels, that's important. And you're also seeing that out of the Beastmaster. He's positioning really far forward. He's still getting okay experience and farm.
They've done a good job so far of making sure that Jirax can get some space around the map. I think he made the right adjustment and realizes that the Earthshaker is going to be camping that Invoker, so he decides that he's going to abuse this offlane, and once again,
they're going over top lane. Malifus done over on Faith. Jirax is just rolling Boulder available. Fada.
Three times a turn.
Bear on him, and there it is. Boulder in front. This time, the body block will also be there. Faith, stick charges up. Does he have enough life to save the Nightmare? Keeping Jirax out. The Bear can't do enough damage in the pause. They have to wait. Ice is having issues. He'll disconnect out. He's over in the middle lane. We got an orb of venom currently ticking down the Beastmaster that no one else is in range from Liquid to hit.
That's one of those. It was unfortunate because there's no way that that pause was timed, but that was like, contemplate what you just did wrong, as the Beastmaster barely gets away, but once again, he has to play so much safer than he has been throughout this entire game, playing way too far forward and not just simply not respecting the power of the Earth Spirit.
Yeah, Innocence was also really good in being able to rotate top. If this Beastmaster is going to be playing so far forward, which we can agree he shouldn't be that far forward without backup, at least the Bane was able to make the rotation in time and being able to save his life. Because you look at what Mind Control's doing, right? He's doing the exact opposite of pushing himself forward in lane. He's actually sitting there in the offlane camp. He decided, nope. Okay, that was enough danger for me, thank you. I'm not going to go into that lane again. And, you know, these sort of offlanes, it's actually more reminiscent of older offlanes where it was kind of like a suicidal lane. But the important part is, while you may die a few times in lane, you can't overly feed. You need to still be able to get your levels up. And that's something that Mind Control is making sure he does not do.
Fun little attempt there by ISIS. He tried to actually catch up to Jirax, but he rolling bolted early enough. So the Fissure from ISIS ends up being wasted, and Matumman, he's making a play for the top rune. Now there is no mana. Okay, now it is there for the Fissure, thanks to the clarity, but Matumman breaks off the pursuit and will not go for it.
Yeah, instead he's going to go for this bottom rune, and if he does manage to get down there, it's going to be the regen. It's going to help him out a little bit, and we start to see the Earthshaker just rotating up to this top lane. We want to make sure that the Beastmaster gets an okay time, and I think the main reason why they're sending both his wards here is because he opted not to go for the Iron Talon and try to contest the lane, thinking it was going to be largely a one-on-one against the Fada Londrip, but with the jungle camps blocked off on the right side and the Earth Spirit unable to gank mid because of the Earthshaker, they just kind of made that adjustment in-game.
Yeah, so this is definitely the advantage.
Oh, the kick! Block kick! Able to hit with a rolling boulder after Matumman. At least do a little bit more damage here. He's got ramped up cooldown, charges himself forward. He's underneath the tower, but he hasn't finished the job. 27 life they drop down to. Now it's both Liquid Heroes
injured and walking around the Radiant Ancients. They got a dire observer, so they'll see the movement as Jirax loops around. Up on the top lane, the bear will be brought down. Fada, he'll keep walking himself away to safety. He's far enough away from the boars.
That could be just as important as actually getting a hero kill. You've got a decent amount of experience, a large amount of gold from that rotation. So that was actually really well played. The Regent's still not being spotted out.
If Jirax walked just a little bit further to the side, he would have seen it. And that would have allowed him to actually gank bottom lane, but...
Okay. Bottom lane is a tough lane to gank. Jirax, I'm pretty sure like he's only going to go for that if they bring like the Enigma with some sort of smoke gank when he's level 6. That's just one of those heroes that is... Like, you make so much effort to try and get it, and it's not ever guaranteed, unless you have an AoE disable like the Enigma does.
I do like, though, that Liquid is going to get a lot more of this offlane now. It's harder for the Slark to be able to contest this Tidehunter just because you can continuously use
the
Anchor Smash.
The kick, it actually connects over on Shadow. Yeah, but he still breaks free and moves over, and this actually baited Mind Control to come out a little bit further with a Sun Strike from Nightmare setup. Shadow gets the perfect tether off. Can Mind Control survive this? His Anchor Smash hasn't done enough. He's moving back towards the tower. Jirax can't create space, and he actually backs up Shadow. He comes back in to get the Jirax punching Wings, who get overconfident. That's a big kill to take. Jirax, he was the walking wound in the bottom lane. At the same time, Kuro will actually get picked off by Ice Ice. He was just farming up a side camp. Then the middle lane also, a little bit of chip damage everywhere, but it ends up being a one-for-one trade-off.
I can't believe Ice Ice just rolled up there and killed Kuro with the Fisher, but that is the advantage of that aggressive ward that they laid out near that offlane camp.
That bottom gank, it looked like it was going to be successful. The Slark just didn't want to hard commit for that. He sort of made this hemming and hawing play where he committed hard with barely any HP, but he didn't want to go that hard. He just didn't want to die, but Jirax was still there waiting with the rolling boulder, and you start to see why it's a priority ban for most teams against Liquid.
Yeah, that was a mistake that the Slark really can't afford. He should never
die on top. Here they go. Kick to start it off. Look for an entangle. 2 hits won't be enough for it. They're looking for more. Ice Ice comes in with the stun. Sun Strike's on its way with a Savage Roar, forcing both Face and Ice Ice to unwillingly walk away.
Meanwhile, mid lane, again, the Phantom Lines are just doing the PL thing. You're going to see these heroes, Phantom Lines are run at the Invoker quite a bit. But we're getting to that moment where the laning phase is coming to a close. I'm more interested in what the movement's going to be from here, from both sides. What really should be done?
Not really sure what the next play is for Liquid anyways, just because your Enigma still hasn't really been able to get online. He does pick up the level 6.
Yeah, she draws the line for it too. So the line just smoke up and go around the back of the mid lane by the looks of it.
He might actually just run into Innocence though, which is the last thing that he wants to do in this situation. This is a decent maneuver though, just because Ice Ice is at this top lane and they know they're pinging him out like crazy, but the Invoker's gonna make the good move up here, just immediately start rotating up for this rune. He's in a really good position, even picks up the illusions, and Kuro still wants to set up on this mid lane, but
Mind Control?
You can see how important the mid lane is for Kuro at this point, because as soon as Mind Control scouts out the Bane, they're like, there's no rotation over.
Oh, they're
pinging. Already go out. Kuro, I think Kuro moved around this tree a little bit too far, and I think Wings ended up spotting him because it's daytime. The nighttime movement, if he'd just done it maybe 15 seconds earlier, it would have been perfect for Kuro because it's still night at that point. He could have gone for the dive, but now Mind Control is in trouble.
He's going to trigger off the Ravage to try and survive with the Anchor to smash. The kick is there to connect the ball! Jirax, you are so beautiful! Find the kill over on the Slark. Ice Ice with a Fish, however, again, a rebuttal kill. Taking out Mind Control and bringing that talent down. That's the first Ravage blow that we see this game.
Man, Urshaker games like this are so fun when you just get to roll through the laning phase and Fisher people for the last hit. He's actually going to get a pretty decent progression at items at this point with the way he's picking up these random kills, but it is so much bigger that Jerry's continually picks off this Lark like he really just shouldn't be able to yet.
Yeah, you're going to be incredibly happy with those kinds of trades where Earth Spirit's going to get a lot of experience because he's in the region for those kills. He's setting up kills on the Slark and just slowing down his timing, whereas if you look on the flip side of things, the Lone Druid completely untouched. He already has 2 kills. He's got the Midas completed. The Slark looked like he was going to go in a similar direction, but with an equivalent amount of CS, not nearly close enough just because of those deaths.
10 minutes in, I would say that this is about the point where both teams are going to be trying to prioritize taking a little bit of objectives. Liquid have a lot more capabilities thanks to the lone droid pick. It does seem to kind of fit Liquid's playstyle. If they can actually get into this moment of time, it's probably more like 20 minutes is what we're looking at, but when they have mech, the lone droid is kind of coming online, and oh, that gank on mid.
It's going to be difficult, but maybe not impossible. Not once you get that 9 meta set up. Oh, they got Echo Flame as well as normal, starting with a Sunstrike from the Invoker. Say goodbye to your Phantom Lancer. It was Liquid who was trying to poke for something else, and with a haste rune, they might be able to get this. The Dire Observer Ward facing Grand Topper, so G-Rex starts with the Silence. There's no possibility for the Roar. Fado's coming in as well. Can they get some level of control? They cannot. They can't hold him there, and now it's Wing's turn. They turn around with a Roar on G-Rex, and the Brain Sap finally, an Entangle will come out from the Bear. As Team Liquid just have to back off the top lane.
That is the one big thing. Like, we really feel that Earth Spirit is one of the strongest heroes in the game right now, but just because he has this really long initiation range and incredible disables, he is a little lacking on damage. You could see it in that situation right there with the Beastmaster.
Mind control.
That close.
Fissure, stun, they're gonna look for the leech as well. That damage on the shadow is high. The Sunstrike's coming in, but mind control reads it. You like a smash again? Now he's come Kuru. He can black hole throw, but it's too late. Oh boy, oh boy.
And that should have been the third kill on the Slark this game in 11 minutes, but Kuro drops the ball there.
That Midnight Pulse almost found the kill as well. It was just on the edge of the Slark. He got out of range of it, and then the Black Hole came out, but it was all too late.
They still have the Ravage timing, though, to go off of, and although that was really unfortunate at bottom, they can still make plays around it. That's more of one of those just morale hits more than anything, because it's going to embolden the Slark. He's going to feel pretty confident now that he knows that he forced a hero to use such a big ability. It doesn't really slow down the timing too much of the pushes or anything like that, and more than anything, you just want to use these Black Holes early game to nab these single engagements, but Wings is going to feel pretty good just because they were able to get both their Midases.
It's a nightmare. They're starting up on top, but I think Wings would be really sad they did this. Kuro, they're going to roar on him with a Sunstrike. Kirax being gripped up. The two supports to control. Midnight Pulse will go down, but Kuro is dying right now to the Necros. How does he get himself out of this one with extra health? Maybe that's the way to do it. The Wrath of Liquid bringing in the support. The Tumberman lands now off cooldown. Will chase down the Beastmaster, the Doppelganger forward. He doesn't know she had the Phantom Rush just yet. He's going well deep under the tower. Ice is rotating over. This Earthshaker has been everywhere at the right time. Doppelganger is on cooldown for 3 seconds. Batonman doesn't have a way out. The Sunstrike's going to connect. The axe as well. It goes and only hits once. Doppelganger is up. Here he goes, but Ice is waiting for it. He doesn't have vision. 3 seconds for the tower. That'll do the job. And the PL will be punished.
A Tumba man, way too big a move for his britches there. That was not a play that he could afford to pull off there with these small individual mistakes that are being made. Blitz, you know, the call was right. The fact that the bottom lane engagement where they messed up the Black Hole, that was not really impactful to Liquid strategy. But if they continue to make these kind of mistakes, it's really going to mess them up. It's going to slow down their timings rather by a rather large amount. And then you start getting into the danger where the Slark can reach his carry point in time. Before Liquid are able to take too many of the objectives that they're searching for.
Yeah, I think the biggest difference with Liquid in the last two games as opposed to their tournament run so far is oftentimes when they get aggressive, they're used to these moves working out, but Wings, they're just kind of sitting back, letting things fall into their laps, waiting for opportunities where they can go for the counter initiations, and that's where the Earthshaker pick and the Bane pick especially start to make a lot of sense, just because the Invoker can continue to farm, he gets spaced through the pressure exerted by the other heroes on the map, and Liquid, they're a team that feels antsy almost. They want to make something happen at all times. They want to try to open up the map. But when you constantly do that and Wings plays this defensive style,
this is what they're doing. The kick's going to come out. Gearox was prepping for it. The Tidehunter mind control was so far down. Now they know that Innocence as well as Ice, they're in the tree line. You do have Ravage available, but will not be required. Innocence is going to lock himself in the trees. The Doppelganger, they break through that. The Fear Jaw.
No way!
No! He doesn't get out. There was still enough illusions for this. They get the kill over on the Bane, but the trade-off is your tier 1 tower on top.
Yeah, I think Wings are definitely getting the better of this situation. They took the tier 1, and they can still definitely defend their safe lane tower if they want to, but it seems like they're probably just going to keep on going. You don't want to be fighting into the Ravage. You know Liquid have hit a certain kind of timing where team fights are dangerous. What's the point of going to it if you can just trade?
Bottom tower. Gonna get harassed by Metema Man, but he just does not have damage. And
there's extra health. Fada's gonna come over. If he can get a good entangle here over onto the Invoker, maybe there's a chance. The Boulder forward from Gearax, he'll get the kick. The Bear's got more chances. The Savage Roar sending the Beastmaster away. They'll protect the top tier 2 tower, but Kuro, damn, he's still so damn low.
Whoa,
and maybe Kuro walks to the side!
No! Oh,
my. He'll go down. Jirox was so low as well as, well, minions rule.
So hard to stop this push with the heroes that they have available. And Vada is still trying to chance that route, but doesn't want to lose the bear if possible.
And note that Liquid abandoned that tier 1 tower push in order to try and get there in time, but they were still a little late. They obviously messed up and are losing up Kuro. They don't get the pick off the Invoker, and they're still probably going to lose their tier 2 tower. This is just the nature of the Beastmaster plus the Invoker, and this is exactly what Wings... I want to go back to what Blitz said about kind of the calm confidence that Wings has right now. I feel like this is the biggest strength of this team, is that they're a reactive force, they have a lot of confidence in their picks, and they're just allowing Liquid to make all these mistakes and just... basically capitalizing on it every single time, as they do once again.
Yep, they take out Fada's bear, so he'll have to resummon, but he's only got it up in 7 seconds time. They're waiting for the initiation time. You've still got Roar available. So Liquid put mind control on the front lines. If you want to initiate onto something, you go up against the tanky Watermelon. The Beastmaster sees everything too. That Hawk has seen Jirax perfectly. Yeah, he knows he's being watched. The Forge Spirit attacked over the Fog of War.
Even in this situation, Liquid still look to defend this tier 2 tower. They don't want to give up too much space, and they know that there's max 4 heroes up here.
I think only Bottle hasn't shown themselves.
Jirax is... okay, this is just a simple Fiend's Grip. If Jirax didn't get the silence off, Kuro's making his play to bring in more help. The Shadow pounces away up to the cliffside, so Innocent, he'll go down, sure. You defend your tier 1 tower, and Shadow will have to wait just a moment. But that's a heavy rotation from Liquid, and the tier 2 tower is still gone.
Yeah, notice where the map controller really is right now. The fact that Wings have managed to take that tier 2 at the top lane, and yet bottom lane is still being pushed out. Liquid have no space to be able to farm, and they can't
initiation,
afford
initiation, Sunstrike. They do actually have Roar available too. Mind control with the Necro unit. Ice, he's going to commit the Echo Slam as well to ensure the kill. And they're actually starting to pressure towards the tier 3 tower, while Liquid, they want to attack the bottom tower, but Shadow's there to debush.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, Wings just keep on forcing this, and Liquid keep on making the mistakes, and now they're just getting to a point where they're actually getting so damn big that we may even see a tier 3 tower go down before 20 minutes, and that's purely the power of this Invoker pushing power with the Beastmaster, who's managed to get his Necro Book at a great timing.
More importantly than that, the Earthshaker's about to complete the Blink Dagger too, just 200 gold away, and... hey, Ice in both these games so far has completely dominated the early game for Wings. This style of play where he was able to just camp around, make the adjustments, try to find opportunities. Of course, it helps when he was able to just last hit Fissure 3 or 4 times, but they're going to be incredibly satisfied with this Blink Dagger.
And this will now change the swing of the team fight power a lot more in the favor of Wings. You know, it was supposed to be Liquid with these double big time ultimates, plus the mech and the lone druid reaching kind of early peak in some ways, you could say, once he has that radiance. But the fact that they have to deal with a Blinken Earthshaker who's going to be able to potentially just, with his combo, one-shot the Phantom Lancer, or at least disable him long enough for Wings to get the quick kill, that Liquid may not actually be able to take those 5 versus 5s that they were thinking of.
So how does Liquid then get their combo? Kuro's starting to bank up a little bit. Does he look for the early Blink Dagger? Do you still try and wait out for Fardus Radiance? He's been working on this for a while. He finally has the Relic.
Hey, no matter what engagement that you're going to take next on the side of Liquid, you're going to wait for that Radiance. There's no reason not to. It's probably the biggest power spike that you're going to see out of a lone druid, and that's exactly what you normally go for. As soon as you ditch the idea of pushing with your team and Wings right now. And the biggest thing about the Earthshaker Blink Dagger going off so early too is that he's got kill potential with just one other hero on the map. That's so rare to have, especially when you're playing against heroes like the Phantom Lancer. Usually it takes 2 or 3, but if the Earthshaker can just solo initiate, set up things like the Sunstrike up a different lane, it's usually just enough damage.
A Tumberman may regret being down here for a little bit, and he backs up a little bit, understands the fact that, well, while it still does have that tier 1 tower there, that nowhere is really safe. The Fissure stop the attack, the creep wave's coming in, no Echo Slam required. In fact, it wasn't even available, it was still on cooldown.
See what Blitz was talking about? That was just 2 heroes off the map. The top lane was being pushed in. They actually showed the Slark and went ahead and said, hey, I'm still up here, I'm still pushing down this lane. They're gonna try for and hunt for him now, but he's already got his Blink Dagger, so he can make that kind of clean escape. When he's got these kind of items, he can show himself and put pressure, and so was Fate. Fate's actually throwing his summons into
Jirax
the lane.
Gonna go for the kick. He keeps that control over on the Beastmaster. Roar will happen. You got Gush and Malphus, but Jirax is going down. Everything is just being brought together. A magnetic personality is Shadow, he also goes up for Kuro. Liquid are losing too many heroes across the map. Mind control now, the Echo Slam! Finally controls the Ravage, has to to MySpace. Damage Roll working with it. Ice, he'll go down and see the tower. Finally, money coming the way in the tangle as well. Vada, he needed this. A double kill for him. The BT forward on the back of that PL. Maybe with the third strike, Vada. Be careful! Oh, you got nailed! Face still on the run. Matama will finish up the job that Vada did start. That presence of mind.
That was so big that he managed to pick off the Lone Druid like that, because that was the play, that was the fight where finally Wings were the ones who made a bit of a mistake, and Liquid were actually going to be able to, like, okay, we can finally gain some ground back, we've been losing so much, until that pick off of the Lone Druid, which just throws everything back even.
And the ability for them to capitalize on that mid fight, it looked like Liquid is, like you said, they were going to turn things around. But that's one of those situations where you just forget about the Invoker. You don't think about the Stunstrike because you're getting in that moment. You have to take a look back and say, okay, maybe there is something like that coming. The Invoker hasn't showed himself on the map. He's taking advantage of the space that his team is creating. But that's so hard to account for the Lone Druid. How are you going to expect something like that to happen when you're just on the offensive?
And he also may not be expecting that the Sunstrike would do that much damage this early on into the game. He didn't have it yet, but he does have it now. The Axe Invoker is already online. And that was a timing that we were talking about during the draft that is really important for Liquid to exploit, but that timing is gone, right?
Yeah, he's just been able to farm more than anything. But I guess the good news is that the Lone Druid still picks up a lot of farm and a lot of levels as a result of that engagement mid. They only lost, they still had a somewhat favorable matchup just here in this mid lane. Matama Man, they're looking for it again. They have so much initiation on them.
They'll have to start with the Fissure once again and then jump in. Follow up, the Sunstrike, a lot of damage. The PL brought down, it was actually the Bane's final nuke. They put him under and the tier 2 tower can be exposed. Meanwhile, Vada calls in the tree lines. The kick from Jirax will buy a little bit of space for the Lone Druid to maybe walk back out. He's got no mana and now no life. Rocks down by the movement of Shadow and he actually leeches the Tidehunter. There's no Ravage, there's no control. The kick comes in from Jirax, but nothing gets off Shadow, especially when you torn into the Tidehunter up. That's a lot of momentum up in the air, but he still falls down to death. Team Liquid, they are on the ropes right now.
And this is the part where the Slower can get really in these team fights constantly. He's got the Blink Dagger, he's got the mobility to be able to jump in and out. They're going to be able to use this map control and combine it with the sustain that they have. And Wings will just go for pickoff after pickoff, team fight after team fight, because they know it's so damn big. They have so much. If they can ever force a mistake out of Liquid, they'll be able to turn one kill into three, four, take a tier three. They've already done it at the top lane at 22 minutes.
This is so brutal as well. They don't even know what lane they can defend. The mid tower is so low, and the top one was already low from the early chipping from Wings previously. So they couldn't even split. They had to split up their heroes when they're already down two players. Now, however, they're coming back up. The kick was on the Invoker. That Invoker is still... He's got his army of four spirits on the front line, and they're going to back out.
Once again, Wings really know how to position themselves when it comes to capitalizing on pickoffs. The way that they push down both of those, the top lane as well as the mid lane, managed to take both those tier threes. They're not making much commitment for great gains.
Yeah, more than anything, this just opens up the map for them. Being able to push those two tier three towers, it means that if Liquid take one bad fight, all of a sudden that's going to mean double set of racks. Now they can choose the landscape of the fight. If they decide to go for the Roshan and Liquid decide to take that fight outside there, could potentially just mean the end of the game if Wings decides to push up mid. As we know, even Bear isn't that great for buyback, especially if he doesn't have the summon Spirit Bear. That's one of the downsides of the hero, and right now things are rapidly falling apart for them because they just don't have enough lockdown for the Slark. The Invoker is way too much farm, especially with the Blink Dagger completed now too. It's going to be too hard for them to get a handle on him, and without a Blink Dagger on the Tidehunter, it's going to be quite difficult. Once again, they're going to rely on this Blink Dagger from the Enigma. They're just going to have to call on Crow to make some sort of big play.
This is the kind of situation where a team who's been being riddled with mistakes via Wings' timed aggression at certain times and their calm confidence of being able to respond there. You're asking them to make no more mistakes, and that I just highly doubt that's going to happen. Liquid are doing something smart, though. They're trying to force some positioning here.
Is this smart when you see Earthshaker waiting on the sideline, itching for a level 2 Echo?
But that's the point, right? It's just impossible. Dota is a game of mistakes through and through. You can't ask five different people operating independently to not make a single mistake in positioning, so they know that the mistake is going to come. But if they can have that mistake on at least near the river, maybe in somewhat of a neutral position, maybe Wings, when they get they find that opening, they take that kill, they're not able to immediately go high ground and take a lane.
Oh, Ice jumps in, goes for the instant accuracy slam. You have the full silence on the way, but the Sunstrike still will connect over on Kuro. He's so low, but Ice ticked down. Oh gosh, Shadow instantly there for the rebuttal. Team Liquid, do you want to try and push for more? The only opportunity you've actually got is Innocence. With that Landsform, Matumba does have Diffuser Blade to charge his Bubble, and he goes through Innocence pretty quickly. That gives a double kill, actually, to Kuro's Enigma after death.
And that's the second time, actually. I think there's only two really big mistakes here by Wings. In fact, I'm not even sure they're that big. They're relatively minor, but it does allow Liquid a small opening. First time was mid at the Tier 2. This time, it's the jump in by the Earthshaker. Liquid being able to get those kills are going to be able to gain something if they can get Roshan, but Earthshaker knows how important that is for Liquid to make.
They find an opening. They found the Earth Spirit. Girac's in trouble. Can he get out of this one with one charter? He will not survive.
And it really didn't cost them much to be able to recover from that. I mean, an Earthshaker buyback when he already has his Blink Dagger, that doesn't mean much. And Wings, they've got great Roche taking heroes between the Invoker and the Beastmaster. Liquid, I think this is their best opportunity. I'm not sure if it's better for them to fight into this Roshan pin or wait for a high ground push.
I think part of the issue is just that because the Tidehunter doesn't have that Blink Dagger, Wings knows that they can always disengage no matter what happens. Unless the Enigma gets some sort of crazy black hole, but he's showing himself mid. They've got a lot of different ways to deal with that with the Earthshaker Blink Dagger. Almost no way for Liquid to open up into that fight. And most importantly, how are they going to get vision? They don't want to send the bear in there just in case he gets stunned up and dies. At that point, it's even worth it for Wings just to go for the roar on the bear, take him down once while you're going for the Roshan. You deny all vision to Liquid at that point, and even if the bear had buyback money, what could you do without your bear twice?
Yeah, and a reminder that this is a position that Wings were never supposed to be in for at least another good 20 minutes. I mean, they've got so many items flooding in, and they're only going to be able to build that up more. Now, I doubt Liquid, if they push this for another 10, 15 minutes, yes, that's their only chance of coming back, but you still have to deal with the double minuses up between the Slark as well as the Invoker, so they've got better control, they've got better items to be able to keep farming up. Wings are just going to build and build and build, just like they did last time in game one, where they eventually chipped Liquid to death.
Not really sure what Beastmaster goes for next. Be Vlad's, but items don't really matter to them too much, as what they really just want to look for is pickoffs. They've got pretty much the prerequisites to end the game on their team. They're just waiting for Liquid to leave the base. They don't want to go for one of those overextensions again. You saw what happened when the Earthshaker, even with that three-man Echo Slam, when it was by that Tier 2 tower and he was in no man's land, they just got chased down.
Liquid need to find some level of confidence to come out. So yeah. They just sit inside the base, and Wings will continue to farm up the map and get further and further ahead, but they are making their move out and to the Dire Jungle. It's still very, very, like, the summons and the illusions, the only things in the front line until Matumbaman hit by the fissure. Shadow, he's thinking about the jump, but it will not commit. They are giving no, like, there's not even an opportunity for a mistake.
Think about it from Liquid's position, right? If you were just to use their vision and look at this game, you see practically no heroes on the map constantly, only because of your aggressive wards, which will eventually be taken care of by either Gem or Slark, Scott, you know, hey guys, there's a ward here, etc. Like, those will be taken care of. Once those are off, there's like no vision whatsoever that Liquid have to be able to see. They're just getting pushed in by summon, and at any point in time, four heroes can blink on you. Four! Like, and one of them's an Earthshaker, which is kind of like one of those insta-kill heroes. And all they can really do to get any semblance of map control is do what they just did, push out with the lone druid bear, try and do something there, and then immediately gets destroyed by the invoker.
They're still in the okay position because they can always fall back on the late game advantage of the Phantom Lancer and the Spirit Bear, but as things progress, I mean, this invoker is just starting to get out of control, and this Lark, not really sure how they're going to be able to kill him.
He just looks immortal at the moment, but here comes Liquid. They group around, they've got a nice opportunity to try and go for some kind of initiation on Shadow, but you see ISI's position. He is exactly where he needs to be, just in the tree line, off, out of vision of Team Liquid, and now there's a jump over on Mind Control. The Thanos there from Georax, but Shadow just dark packs it off, and ISI's... He jumps in, there's your Echo Clan! Tornado will fly through, but the Earthshaker's already gonna go down with Mind Control, being focused. He just wants to TP out, and will he? No! Not successful! Big AoE controllers for Team Liquid. The Tumbleman is going to get out just in the nick of time. Back to base. Whoa. Everything's fine. That's if you're Wings, because you're in a great position now.
Oh yeah, Wings are very happy. I mean, they just managed to get the farming Enigma as well as the 3 position from Liquid for their 2 supports. It's not the fight they dreamed of, for sure, and it's not probably the nastiest fight that Liquid has encountered just yet, but it is another small opening where Wings might be able to get a Range Rex here. They're going to go back in. Shadow's just like, yeah, I'll take this. I still got Aegis.
Oh, what's Summerman really going to do to him? Like, okay, you can burn off a little bit of the mana. The Rax actually had to be fortified, but up on top lane, you've now got the Beastmaster attacking into the melee Rax. They're being poked and prodded on all sides unwillingly. Maybe if you can get an entangle, there's 2 attacks into the Savage Roar, which actually didn't even connect on Fate.
That's a jab.
Oh, the Aegis is down. They're going to be able to play. Oh, but there's a Fissure! Koro, there's nothing else to really follow up, however. Shadow as well as Ice Ice, they're all over it. And Shadow will keep going for the kill. Jumps forward, now away, up on top lane. Farda, he's gonna go down to the Invoker and walk inside the Ice Wall. Ravage be committed, they need that damn kill for Shadow! He got back, but it's too late! In for Innocence, will also drop the Fissure. More space, big range, the Phoenix Grave for Thumba! There it is! He's able to find the pick. They look for more. Jirax wants to kill over an Ice Ice, the Thorn in the Liquid side. They will bring him down. He won't be able to fight. They kick his corpse away, respecting the dead, obviously. The Team Liquid, they defend, but you do lose your melee on top.
Yeah, that was kind of nasty. The big downside for Liquid was the fact that they actually lost their lone druid in that fight, and the big winner of the team fight was actually Jerix, and the Earth Spirit with the extra gold isn't going to be nearly as effective as many of these other heroes. The upside is they're still alive. They're still in this game.
Ever so barely.
They still do have
mind control. You actually, he's dead. Yeah. He couldn't walk himself away from that. Invoker's just combining up magical ice and fire. And they just can't escape. I think they also understand where Kuro is. Thanks to that Observer Ward, the Hawk will come up and Kuro very quickly blinks himself away and will get back to the tier 3 tower.
Not a whole lot more objectives for Wings to go for outside the base. They're gonna start their push. Liquid. All they really need is one fight to get in.
Liquid just have to find the opening where the black hole ravaged it. Those,
you got 100 seconds
of
black hole
for a while, yeah.
Like, Ravage, you've still got 1 minute.
So how do they possibly stop this push for a full minute?
This one's going to be difficult because Wings have probably taken down the timer for it, and they know for a fact that there's at least a minute for both those abilities. Not a whole lot that they can do, and that's why Wings, despite the scariness that these two heroes naturally present, they're just going to go for it anyways.
Oh, they try and get that kickoff, not going to work. Beastmaster Roar instantly goes on to that Embers, that Earth Spirit, and with the pushback, they find the kill. The double buybacks are on their way. We're over the front line, but who are you going to control? Innocence looks to be the only target that Liquid can go on to, but the anchor is back. Ice Ice will arrive. They're still that mind control to move forward with the proc of the Kraken Shell. Ice Ice will go down, but some of us are seeing a real issue right now. Tag doesn't have enough damage. The bear is still alive. This was the only summon, but really, what's the cost? You've still lost your entire mid lane. Your melee Rax on the top is going down. You lose Earth Spirit, you lose ES, you lose the Bane. That's all.
Yeah, they're going to be incredibly satisfied with that trade-off just because they got the buildings. They got what they came for. All they really need now is one solid push at bottom. The Beastmaster can always clean up top when that's happening. There's not a whole lot that they can do to prevent that. And with this exposed barracks up at top, Liquid, honestly, just, they have to constantly push out that top wave. It's going to allow Wings to make moves around the map. For example, on this bottom half of the map, they can't ever go for the Roshan as a result of this top lane constantly pushing in. Wings have all the information to work for. Now what's going to happen is that Liquid is going to have to play the high ground game, but even then it's quite dangerous.
Yeah, at this point you know you're just going to continually lose out, right? There's just unlikely for you to be able to, especially with the Wings that they've shown really great positioning in both Game 1 and Game 2. You're unlikely to be able to get those big team shadow movements.
The B teams are coming in. They asked for the call. That was a big miles away. And that TP came so quickly. 3 seconds before the initiation happened, it was Faith who was pinging the creep wave, and they both went at exactly the same time.
Yeah, that's the kind of teamfight coordination that you Wings just really showcasing as one of the big strengths. They planned that kill out really well. It was one of those, okay, we're going to force the doppelganger, you're going to catch him, we'll continue our TPs, and once you caught him with the pounce, it's all over from there. But I'm not sure about your opinion, Blitz, but I almost feel like Liquid, they have to start playing. If they get the Phantom Lancer back up in time, they have to start going for like almost aggressive plays. I just don't see them being able to stop Wings.
Phantom Lancer are going to preemptively buy back, and yeah, I agree with you, just because I don't really know. I still think you can use the high ground ability and the Midnight Pulse and the Black Hole, and maybe Wings make a mistake, but that's pretty much what you're gambling here for if you're Liquid, because it's going to take a pretty big mistake from Wings to be able to salvage this game for Liquid. Like, they'd have to blow either the Earthshaker Fissure or his Echo Slam before the Black Hole.
And that's the key word, right, is mistake. And it's a whole lot easier for Wings, who are kind of like sitting outside the base, trying to go high ground, chipping away at you, to kind of plan their initiation. But Liquid, I think they kind of need to like force a mistake, even if it is kind of like a game-losing position for you to go out. They got to go out big.
Here they come. The smoke out, all five here is the one time when the creep wave's not pushing inside the base, so, well, Ice, he actually burns the smoke on Koro right underneath the observe ward that was still in the lane, blinks away, and the smoke will fail.
So well done by him.
Oh, maybe they find the opening, that kick hits on Ice. They have to magnetize him up so he can't just Echo Slam and control him. Any kind of pickoff will work, so maybe this smoke isn't a complete failure. The Earth Spirit, again. Style points for the kick.
Okay, you've drawn out the game for another minute. That's essentially the, like, Liquid, I'm not even sure if they're thinking about the long haul right now. They're just thinking about it step by step, inch by inch. How do we prolong this game? And just, you know, you don't think about how to end the game. You think about how to just
try and put the 20k longer. Deficit of gold in the back of your mind and 14k for experience.
Yeah, a few more of those and maybe Liquid now they're all. They go over on Koro, that Deafening Blast, the mech will keep him alive a little bit longer, but the Invoker, he's such a cannon with the Thumbstrike mind control. The damage is too much, he can't put himself away, the Ravage, however, it'll hit, maybe they can turn, but Harman's got space, the kick will fly through, but the BKB to prevent the center for the moment, he can't really find a good target, he's going down, the Thumbman's walking over, the BKB is bringing in for help. Invoker ball back into the game, but Jirax kicks him once again. The Bears focusing on him. They need to keep that Invoker out. Oh, they're fighting. This could be a shadow dash. The PL, they find another one. They just keep going. The Fissure. I'm but the kick again. Jirax just keeps going to work. But the Beastmaster, he wants to go in just a second. 5 seconds till Roar's off cooldown. Holy cow, I can't believe Liquid actually had the control to be able to stop pursuing for that Invoker. That was such a hype moment that they forced the buyback. They almost killed the Invoker again. They had the chance to pursue, but someone made the call. I'm presuming it's Kuro. Back the hell out, guys. We're getting way too deep.
I think most importantly about that, it was they had so much self-control not to use the Ravage, even with two heroes hitting them. He said, not this time yet. The BKBs are still active, but as soon as they're down there with the Ravage, they're instantly able to pop the Invoker, who is way too aggressive because of that BKB. They still are going to pick up the Aegis, and this is going to go on to the Invoker. And Liquid aren't out of the dangerous territory yet, but they picked up quite a bit of farm on Mutemba Man now.
It's almost like they're tag-teaming their ultimates. Like, we got Ravage for one, we'll have Black Hole for another. We've still got some pause for concern for Wings, and Matumberman just keeps getting bigger and bigger as time goes on.
Yeah, it's pretty nasty, right? The fact that Liquid, even when they win some sort of, like, really crazy, the fact that they came out of that okay was insane, right?
Yep.
The fact that they walk away from that sort of fight, you win, but you still lose. Wings get the Roshan to their hands. The house always wins at this point.
They're underneath a Hawk, and that Observer War from Jirax, they thought Innocence. They try and go over and beat Master Double Kick! Fate got connected on as well! Innocence wants to walk out, even Matoma just falls to Beastmaster in a world of hurt. Too many losers around. The Sunstrike won't hit a real hero. They get into the bait, too. Eyesight, hang him the tree line. Where's the Invoker? He wants to burn down Koro, but Jirax. This guy, he has tasted blood and he wants more. Vada moves forward, but now Shadow, how much respect do you give?
This is so good because we're praising the self-control of Liquid to back out mid-team fight like that and not pursue the Invoker, but at the same time, they're not slowing the game down. Yes, they backed up, but they immediately pushed back out. They can't let Wings kind of get set up in that corral mode that they were in earlier.
And in 5 seconds, they're going to have the Ravage up again, looking for anything that they can. The Invoker not being the prime target here, as he still has the BKB and the Aegis available for himself.
They're going again. But Tumberman, he's right around the corner. Obviously, they don't have the vision here for it yet. They don't know how close they are to a kill. The only one they see is Ice on that tier 2 tower.
Yeah, exactly. You see this Liquid know that they really need to find some additional pickoffs, and they just kind of continue to snowball this, always make it so that Wings are at a numbers disadvantage so they can start taking some objectives. What Wings need to do is slow down the game, say, okay, we screwed up, but you know what? let's not make any more scripts. Let's just sit back. Let's get all five of our heroes. Let's start controlling the map again and reclaim this game.
Well, they seem to already have that advantage, right? You've still got the mid-racks down. You've still got the melee lost on top.
And might be a range racks with these force spirits chipping away at it, too.
The benefit right now is that Liquid are in a much better position than they were in 10 minutes ago. They're able to push out the lanes with, without feeling as if there's going to be a massive team fight. That was one of the major deterrents for them getting any sort of farm, that they just had to send their summons forward.
Mid lane, Tornado Core is going to be picked up by this one. And with the BKB from the Inverter, he wants to fight. Kyle Core, he got passed up. Core needs that black hole. Oh, he's going to get it. Will they have enough? They can't see him. They can't attack him. Beatrip actually dragging Core out of the black hole. He'll go down. The Lone Druid as well as the PL. Enigma will have his, but he has no Black Hole, there's no Ravage. And maybe this is finally that opportunity that Wings were waiting for. They're actually gonna find Jerax.
They don't have Black Hole. Jerax is just trying to lead them on a goose chase at this point in time, getting away from them.
They're chasing
them away from the base a little bit.
They are chasing a long way for this.
I mean, they know they've got plenty of time. They can afford to chase down this skill. It will still have a full minute before the Phantom Lancer is back up. So they claim that kill. They turn right back around. And this should be Megas. I can't really see how Liquid can defend with neither of the Frick Ultimates and neither of their carries. This just seems impossible. Liquid
double
does with a comeback, but it doesn't seem possible.
Mind Control just bought his refresher off to get his Ravage back off cooldown, left it back inside the base, so Wings will feel like there's no Ravage, but he's got no friends. There's no one else to help him survive the pickup and the throwdown with EMP. Mind Control actually needs to go back and regenerate. The Megas up with this last range Rex to fall, and Team Liquid, they stumbled in Shanghai, and it looks like we might be seeing a repeat. Mind Control, he'll avoid. Now is the time, the Ravage for the BKB! It actually is good. Now that's it, that game! The Ravage beats nothing at the end of the day, and Wings are up 2-0 against Team Liquid. Not a single game dropped here until the grand final, where they've lost 2 in a row and are staring down the barrel of a whitewash.
And Wings, a single game away from being able to take this championship. This team, this was their one shot. This is their big opportunity coming from the Chinese region to prove that they were some of the best that could go to this LAN event and prove themselves, and they're doing it right before our very eyes.
Well, at least there's still some smiles over on the Liquid faces. But Wings, they were high-fiving in the end of game number one. The smiles got bigger, the high-fives got harder. Wings looking fantastic in game two. We'll have ourselves a short break. We'll be coming back here game number three. What is in store? Will it be Liquid or will it be Wings?